Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined by possibly an unfamiliar name for you at this moment in time with this episode going out the day before his debut, his Scottish pro wrestling debut. I am joined at this time by KJ Mack. Welcome to the show.
Hello, hello. Thanks for having me.
Looking forward to this. So we've had guests in the past that have wrestled in America that are Scottish, for lack of a better way of putting it. Yeah. Hopefully the audio viewers can heard my rabbit ears going there. But you actually are Scottish.
Yes, indeed. So definitely.
We're going to dive into that a little bit. But the first question is always the same. It's the cliche wrestling question that you get asked on a podcast. What got you into pro wrestling? So what was the moment that got you hooked onto this pro wrestling stuff to the point where you're actually doing it yourself?
You know, it's funny because when I was younger, I wasn't allowed to watch wrestling. My mum, very protective person, didn't like violence and stuff like that. So she didn't like me watching it. So I had some friends at school that liked it, and they had the action figures and stuff. So like, I got into the action figures before I actually got into wrestling itself. And eventually we were on holiday. We were at a caravan holiday. We went to Haggerston Castle. And there was wrestling on, and I was begging and pleading to go because I wanted to watch. And ended up going. I got to see who we didn't know at the time, obviously, but who would go on to become my coaches, actually. BT Gunn in particular is the main one that I remember seeing. Stevie Boy was on the show. There's some debate. We've had the conversation whether Wolfgang was on the show or not. And Jester was on there, like, so I got really into it then. And then after that, my mom was like, okay, cool, you can watch it on TV. And I was like, right, cool. So I used to record it on Sky Plus and watch it the next day. But I went away from it for a while when I went into high school, stopped watching it. And then when I come out the other end of high school, I think it was during like Kofi Mania and stuff, I come back to it. Because I was talking about it not too long ago, the weird butterfly effect of Mustafa Ali getting injured led to me being a wrestler. So it's been an interesting kind of in and out, but I think I've been kind of consistently watching in all forms since maybe about 2019.
Okay, that's fine. That gives me a bit of a time frame to kind of work my brain on. That's fine. But when you mentioned the figures, that's the most fascinating thing. Doing all these interviews I've done, I think, how many is it at this point now? It's 154th, 55th, something like that, interview I've done this podcast. And it's weird how multifaceted wrestling is for people getting into it, because for yourself, it was the action figures that kind of got you in. For a lot of people I've spoke to, it's the video games that gets
that
people
as well.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
And for people my age, it's Channel 4, because they had Heat. They had Heat on Sunday at like 6 o'clock after The Simpsons. Mm. And then they had the pay-per-views in 2000, just showing my age dramatically there for anyone listening. Who for some reason, who by this point, if they're listening to this one for the first time, I'm very, very aware that I'm old in comparison to a lot of the people that I've spoken to. I'm sprightly, only 31 at this point, but still, seeing all you young guys wrestling, like, it's disgusting. As I try and get out from my chair later, my knees go just creep away. So 2019 then, that's quite recent, but you had your little bit of a frolic before when you were younger. It's weird. High school, you're either, if you like wrestling, you're the weirdo. So
yeah, it's one of those things where, like, I think when you get to high school, so I was born in 2000, so I just turned 22 last week. So when you get into high school, I think it's one of those things, either you double down and really become like the wrestling kid, or you like try and like hide it and kind of fall away from it. Mm-hmm. I think you're one or the other. And in my high school, like, I played football and I was also a theater kid. So like, I was like in the middle. Like, I always make the joke that I was like, I lived like a Troy Bolton high school life. Cause like I was playing sports, and sports were my thing, but at the same time, I was doing all the school musicals and stuff. So it was one thing that kind of fell away when I went into high school was wrestling. But I loved it from what I was maybe about six or seven until I started high school. And then I came back to it as an older, wiser, seeing it from the art that it was when I was about 19 and until now.
Absolutely, you're bang on the money, because I was the kid at Double Down. I was the one at Double Down, so I was the wrestling kid. And at that point, it's always the case of, oh, it's not real. Like, I know. I'm 16 at this point. I'm pretty aware. I still like watching it though, so leave me alone.
it's one of my favorite things though. Like when people, I don't know why, because like I've never gone up to someone that's like, oh yeah, did you see the new Doctor Strange movie? And I'm like, oh, you know that's fake, right? Like, like it doesn't actually like have a magical cape. Like I've never held that argument before, so I think it's one of the most ridiculous things when people are like, oh yeah, you know wrestling's fake. And I was like, really? Like I all this time I've been sitting here thinking there was a real undead zombie guy fighting a Christian cowboy on my TV. Like it's just one of those things where like it's so ridiculous. But when I try and explain it to the muggles, as I call them, I'm just like, it's a live stunt show with glitter and theatrics, and I love every minute of it.
I think, I don't know if I do it a disservice when I just say it's year-round pantomime. That's what it is.
Yeah.
If you go to a show, I'm up in the Northeast, so it's a bit different, bit of a different landscape. It's a lot more big kid-friendly characters up here. And it really is. You go for a couple hours and yay, you boo, you cheer, you shake your fist wildly at the bad guy, and it's just madness for that amount of time. And a lot of people, it's like, even my parents and my wife as well, they don't like watching it on telly. Don't get it. Don't understand why. And for some reason, my wife doesn't understand why I rewatch stuff either. It's like, you know what happens? It's like, I know, and it's amazing. That's why I'm watching it again. But she'll go to see it live, because that's just the absolute madness you get with it. It's just wall-to-wall characters and fun. And there's some athleticism involved. It's a very difficult thing. I couldn't do it. I'm not even going to try and do it. It's fine. I'm just happy at this side of the things. So it's just a wonderful art form. So how'd you go from that then? 2019 is when you got back into wrestling. 19 years old. Nice and easy one to remember. Much like myself. Born 1990. So I just add 10 now to whatever year it is.
Yeah.
And how'd you go from that then to go, right, you know what? I play a bit of football. I've got a little bit of a drama background. I'm gonna give this a go.
So it was a funny one. So in 2019, like back end of 2019, I study acting. So that's what I study. So I moved down to Hitchin, which is just outside North London, to do a theatre course. And whilst I was down there, like I had my own flat and stuff, I lived myself. So like I would go to college, I would come home, that was it. I'd go watch Tottenham at the weekends. That was what I did. And I was like, right, I need something else. It was coming up to Christmas. And I was like, right, my New Year's resolution is going to be to try something new, but I'm going to do it a little bit early. So I did my research and stuff. I was like, where are wrestling schools nearby? Couldn't really find any. There was a lot of places in flux. And I found UBW, who a small company just outside London, and they had the UBW Square One Academy. So I was like, oh, great, I'll go there. And those first couple of sessions, I was only there for a small while because it was just before Christmas and then just after Christmas up until the pandemic hit, where we were in a church hall. And the guys were all way more experienced than I was, the only day one there. And basically it was a case of, here's a crash pad. Here's one of the guys that's not busy just now. He's going to teach you how to bump and how to give and take a suplex. Like that was my extent of my training in the beginning. And it was just a case of like, I want to try something new. I'd always loved the thought of wrestling. Like I was actually looking back on some like old like stuff that I did in primary school and stuff, and I remember at the time my mom giving me any trouble for like writing about wrestling, but it was something that was in my head and I thought it'd be pretty cool, and in my mind it's another route into acting, so I was like, right, so if the straight up acting doesn't work out, I could go and wrestle for a while and then come back to it and do what Cena and The Rock did and Batista. Like, just right. like that, that was the kind of mind frame. I was like, right, this could be another route in, and I could do something fun that I enjoy in the process. So we got there and it was, I did that. And then obviously pandemic hit, but then I came back home and I started up at Iron Girders with Wolfie and BT and Stevie Boy.
And the rest, as they say, is history at this point.
Indeed.
So yeah, so that's how I end up at Iron Girders then. So right about that time, of course, things like NXT UK just kind of not even started. They were kind of just on a just going on at the moment. Mm-hmm. So were you aware of a British scene outside of the camp, the holiday camp you went to? How much did you know about the UK scene?
I think the extent of my knowledge was Progress and ICW. That was like the extent of what I knew in terms of indie stuff, in the UK anyway. Because when I was in that in-between phase of like kind of getting back into it, kind of not towards the back end of high school, I went to a couple of ICW shows. Probably shouldn't have been there because most of them were over 18s, but you know, you do what you have to do. But we went to a couple, and then when I left high school and started college, I went to a couple more. I had a couple of friends in my college course that were like really into ICW. So I went to that. Like, so obviously I knew your Grados, your Jack Jesslers, your Rudos and all that. So like it was in that kind of time frame. So that was really all I knew. And I knew some of those guys worked with Progress as well. So I was like, all right, cool. And I think at the time I might be getting my times wrong, but WCPW was maybe a thing at the time. And I knew that,
because
I liked the What Culture videos as I was getting back into things, because I wasn't always watching it. I wasn't watching like Raw and SmackDown every week. So I just watched the What Culture videos and that would like catch me up, heading it into like pay-per-views and stuff. So like I knew WCPW, I knew the kind of stuff they were doing. So like that was kind of my extent of it was a very sheltered indie experience I had. Certainly I would say even up until I moved to America in August, my experience of indie wrestling was very sheltered.
Right. So outside of those, so that's probably your most accessible companies online, very much so anyway. Yeah. The only other one I think that puts up regular stuff like full shows, maybe Discovery as well, possibly in there. Yeah. Okay, so go back a little bit before then, right back to the start. Who your favorites growing up then? So we're talking 2006. Who were your original guys?
It was one of the very first like major pay per views I watched after I started watching, because once again my parents weren't keen on me watching it to begin with, so they definitely weren't keen on paying for pay-per-views, but I managed to convince them it was Unforgiven 2006 was and Edge and John Cena in the main event for the TLC match for the WWE Championship, which to this day I think is possibly my favorite match. It's one of those ones where I always go back and watch it, where it's like, if I want an example of a good storyline that ended in a great match, had a great blow off, I always go back to that. And so Edge was always one of my favorites as a kid. I just thought he was so cool. Like, even though he was like the most horrendous heel, like the most evil bad guy you could think of, I just thought he was so effortlessly cool. And I loved his moveset. I loved his entrance. Like, Metalingus is still on my gym playlist to this day. Like, it's one of the best entrance themes ever. I love Drew just because he was Scottish. He was the only Scottish representation at that time. Like, and now that I'm thinking about it, I was like, I was a messed up kid because I loved heels. like, I liked John Cena, but he wasn't as cool as like Edge and Drew. And I'd probably say at that time, Straight Edge Society, CM Punk.
Okay,
that was that kind of era. I loved it because I remember watching Elimination Chamber, and it was one of the first times where I was like, oh, this CM Punk guy's cool, was Elimination Chamber, maybe 2009, 2010, I think, where he was the first in the ring. I can't even remember who was in there with him, but he eliminated them really quickly and spent about a minute and a half of the 2 minutes until the next guy came in, just sitting cross-legged, cutting a promo in the middle of the Elimination Chamber, and I just thought that was the coolest thing. So Edge, Drew, CM Punk were probably like my big three when I was a kid.
I'll just have a look up the card of Unforgiven 2006, which strangely had a purple like link, so I've clearly I've clicked on this before. And yeah, John Cena, Edge, main event, TLC. I'm just looking for see what else we've got there. We've got Johnny Nitro against Jeff Hardy. That would have been a lot of fun. Kane Umaga, that would have been something. Spirit Squad against the Highlanders. Oh, you were treated.
Oh, dear.
I love the Highlanders. If I ever bring, I'm finishing up the podcast at the end of season four, and it may come back, but if I ever get a chance to interview either of the Highlanders, the podcast is back, because I cannot say no to speaking to either or. I won't even mention TNA to Robbie. To me, everyone watching this will see the panic on my face going, which one was it? It was Robbie. It was definitely Robbie. We've got DX against Big Show and the McMahons in a 3-on-2 Hell in a Cell. Nice. Trish Stratus's last match against Lita. Oh, so you got Crime Time selling off Lita's.
Yes.
No, that's not right. No, Lita's last match would be the month after, I think, that's sold all out. Yeah. Randy Orton, Carlito. So probably would have had a springboard RKO thing as well. Not a bad card. It's great. It's great when you have like that nostalgia for a show, because mine is WrestleMania 15 again, 1999, and it's often hailed as like one of the weakest ones. And I watch it going, why? It was the best.
Yeah,
had a hardcore triple threat to kick off with Road Dogg and Hardcore Holly, Billy Gunn, Hardcore Holly, and Al Snow. What's not to love?
It's one of my things where like it's one of my. One of my only major gripes about wrestling in general is people can't let you just like enjoy the stuff you enjoy.
Mm-hmm.
Like one of my favorite pay-per-views ever, and people are like, oh, it was awful. I loved it because I had it on DVD, and it was one of the first pay-per-views that I owned. And it was Bragging Rights 2009, which was the 60-minute Iron Man between Cena and Orton. It was obviously the Bragging Rights match where Kofi lost his accent. And it was the World Heavyweight Fatal 4-Way, which was Punk, Taker, Rey, and Batista, where Batista turned on Rey after the finish. You had Miz and Morrison had imploded for the first time, so they went to separate brands and they were against each other because they had the two mid-card titles at the time. It was just... loved that pay-per-view, and it was one of the first ones I owned, and then I started collecting them, and people were like, oh, it's such a bad pay-per-view, and I'm like, to me it was amazing. Like, I was 9, what was I going to know? Like, and even now, like, I look back on some of those matches with nostalgia, and like when 2K22 came out this year and I was playing the Rey Mysterio story mode, one of the matches is Rey Mysterio and Batista on SmackDown after that pay-per-view. So I'm sitting there watching the cutscene and I'm like, oh, I know that thing. I know that it was the meme of Leonardo DiCaprio. Like, oh, I know that one. I know that one. Because it was one of the first ones that I owned. Like, I watched some like online and stuff, but that was the first one that I actually owned on DVD. So I loved it.
I had a moment there where you said it was one of the worst. I was like, don't say December to Dismember.
No.
Which I loved. I don't care what anyone says, but still.
I'll hold my hands up and say any of the ECW pay-per-views, because we found out recently, I knew nothing about ECW, like original ECW. I'm going to actually bury myself here. We were on a show in New Jersey, and Shane Douglas was on the card. I had no idea who Shane Douglas was because I was just too young for that era of ECW. Mm-hmm. So my only experience of ECW was WWE ECW. So like with Kofi and Sheamus and John Morrison, like that was my experience at ECW. And obviously One Night Stand with RVD and John Cena and then December to December. Where everyone looks back on it now and like the wrong man won the chamber. Like everyone was hot on Punk at the time and he was desperate to put it on Lashley, I think it was, if I remember right.
And then we got Durag Vince afterwards. So it was all worth it in the end.
Do you know what? That birthed one of my favorite things of this year, was when Cardona won the GCW title and we had Durag Cardona calling back to that Durag fence. So that was, it was worthwhile in the long run.
Exactly. It was, I had to wait a while. I had to wait a while to get there, but it was worth it at the end. No, that's the thing. If I mean, for me, Shane Douglas, I was an ECW guy. I was always a WWF guy in WWE. So, I mean, if I met Shane Douglas, my big memory of him would be when he managed the Naturals in TNA. So, like, I could just imagine his face when he's thinking he's been remembered for all this stuff he did in ECW. For me to go, oh, remember, I can't remember their names, Andy and the other one from the Naturals. That was Ace time when you managed Marcus Candido. I must have been Ace. It was probably looking at me going, I did a lot of stuff in ECW. I was Intercontinental Champion for a night. I did stuff. Like, no. Naturals. That's what I remember. Chase Stevens, Andy Douglas. Yes.
There you go.
Got there in the end. Right. So, yeah. So you had all that. And you had your favorites. When you came back into it, of course, Edge was still there as well. No, he wasn't. He was still retired at that point.
I came back, so it would have been the run-up to Mania 35. So Roman had just come back from his second bout of leukemia, right?
Leukemia, yeah.
Yeah, so he had just come back and he's feuding with Drew going into 35. We obviously had Kofi Mania. I'm trying to think, what was the other? It was the women's triple threat, Ronda, Becky, and Charlotte.
Okay, God, that does not feel like it was 2019.
Yeah.
Way more recently.
So it was Kofi Mania that got me back into it. I had just, obviously, What Culture comes up on YouTube and stuff, and just like it was like, oh yeah, Kofi Kingston done 45 minutes of an hour-long gauntlet. Like, I'll need to go watch this. And then you get hooked right back in. But yeah, so 2019. Early 2019, so Edge wasn't there yet. So I got that moment when I came back.
So yeah, it must have been amazing seeing Edge come back. That would have been the year after? There was a crowd. So yeah, it was 2020. So that must have just been like nuts.
That was one thing. So like, obviously, I was still watching when he retired. So he was like, right, I'm done. I've beat Alberto Del Rio, but I need to go away. I would remember being very upset watching that, because I remember one of my favourite feuds of that year was, which is one that's very much slept on, was Edge and Kane, like a babyface Edge against Kane over the world title, and they like pushed Paul Bearer, or like a Paul Bearer dummy down the stairs in a wheelchair and stuff. Like, it just tormented Kane all night. But so I was still watching then, and then obviously went away. I think that was probably about the same kind of time that I fell away from it, which probably lines up well. Like, my favourite was gone, so why would I keep watching? Mm-hmm. But when I came back, it was actually funny. So I was in my flat in London, and I was watching it myself on the iPad, all the lights out, just my iPad sitting with it on. And I get noise complained the next day because I lost it because I didn't have Wi-Fi at the time. So I was just working off like a little dongle.
God, yeah.
So I only watched that match. Like, I never watched anything else. I just watched the Men's Rumble because I was trying to save my data for the month. But it was like 10, 9, 8, 7, buffering. I was like, oh my God, who is it? And as I came back on, the like smoke, like the is like pyro started going, and it was like garbled, but it was this song, and I just started losing it. And then the next day, I got an email from the landlord that was like, "Hey, people here, were all complaining. It was really loud last night. Were you having a party or something?" I was like, "No, it was just me." So I remember that really well, and I remember like messaging like my brother. He's a very casual wrestling fan, so I was like texting him like, are you watching it, Edge is back. So I was losing it. I turned into that 6-year-old kid again the minute my Wi-Fi caught up to what was going on.
Oh God, I remember the living on my own in a flat with a three dongle. It was some you had to make some choices.
Yeah.
You had to go, right, it's 2 days to the end of the month. I've still got 10 gig left. Do I watch something or do I download something? Do I get a game for the PlayStation or something? Oh, yeah. There's decisions. Mine was, I think it was WrestleMania. It was 30, I think. I was trying to watch. And with that, no, 29, 29, because CM Punk, Undertaker. And it was, buffer. And it was just about, the match just about finished. CM Punk, Taker, great match, enjoying it. And then it was 1-2, buffer. And then it came back with the Undertaker celebrating. I was like, ah, great.
Well, that happened.
I assume he won. Unless something's happened in between, I've missed. But it was, I don't miss those days. Thank God for Wi-Fi in general. Yeah. Oh God, I can't go back those days. Although sometimes I don't know what Vodafone is like up here. For some reason, it used to just dip out constantly. I had to reschedule an interview last week because I unplugged everything to move stuff about, plugged it back in, and then Wi-Fi wouldn't come back on for 3 hours. I was like, right, okay, well,
yeah.
You soon learn there's nothing on TV. You lose your Wi-Fi.
You just twiddle your thumbs and hope for the best.
Pretty much, just praying that your phone data survives a couple scrolls of TikTok and just hope it's worth it. And you're not just like getting three in a row with the same bloody sound, that Lizzo or something. Right. So you start Iron Girders. You came back up. Start Iron Girders.
Yeah.
So Wolfgang, Stevie Boy, BT Gunn, what have you? August was when you ended up going to New York. So was it due to just acting opportunities, studying? How did you end up starting there and then end up going to the US?
Yeah, so basically I was applying, like my mum's a teacher, so she's really big on education. So she was really, really keen for me to get my degree, go do your degree, whatever that may be, and then at the very worst, if nothing works out, you can go back and like, teach. I was like, all right, okay, cool. So I applied for like 12 different like degree courses for acting up and down Scotland, England, Wales. I think there was even one in Ireland. Got nothing. I got to like the last round of recalls for most of them and they just didn't get in. And then I got reminded that there was this place called the Atlantic Acting School in New York. And because of the pandemic, they were doing all their auditions on Zoom. And it's a really really high reputation place. Like a lot of the Avengers came out of there and stuff. So like, I was like, oh, that's really cool. Let's apply there. Cause it was like 15 quid to apply. Whereas a lot of the other ones were like 60. So I was like, right, I'll send a self tape, see what happens. And they got back to me and they're like, right, cool. We want to do a Zoom audition. I was like, right, great. Did the Zoom audition. And about a week later, I got a scholarship to go. So I was like, right, cool, pack my bags, we're going to New York. And then ended up going out there for that. But I was like, I need to take the wrestling with me, so I need to get in touch with everywhere I can, try continue this, because I think it's something that I'm really good at. So I ended up out there on acting.
So you end up at the Fallout Shelters where you ended up going to, or was there a couple of places you tried first?
So I've told this story a couple of times with people that are in that circle, but basically I emailed every wrestling company in the New York area, like all of them, and I think six got back to me. Like, so I sent out these emails like all about this time last year actually, and only six of them got back out of like 20. So that was like frustrating, but the first one to get back was the Fallout Shelter and Joakim and Elliot. They were pinging me back and forth like instant. Obviously there's a time difference, but they were still like sharp. So I was like, do you know what, these guys have given me a time of day, I want you to go try there first. So I flew to New York on the Monday. I got there on the Monday and I was in training on the Tuesday. Like I started like that quickly. And I went in and I tried it. And I've told the guys this before, I didn't like it when I first went because my experience up until that point had been one-to-one sessions with Wolfie, Stevie Boy, BT. And then I went over there. My first class, there was like 20 people there. And I think when my first session, I think I did a roll. I think I took one bump. I think I did an up and over. That was all I did the whole session. I was like, this maybe isn't for me. But I had paid for the month. I was like, right, cool, I'll go back. Then on the Thursday, I went back and it was a lot better. I enjoyed it a lot more. I just started talking to people, socializing. And they were like, and that weekend was SummerSlam. So like, you know, come with us, come to SummerSlam. It'll be great fun. I was like, all right, okay, cool. Went to SummerSlam, had the best night. I learned very quickly that drink was expensive in New York, put it that way. It was a very expensive night out, and then I just kind of stuck with it, and very quickly I just got to know everyone, and it very quickly became a home away from home. And Joachim, Elliot, Paul, Yokai, they had created this school along with the coaches that just became home for me, and they very quickly became family. It's where I spend all my time. Like, I go to college Monday to Thursday, 9 to 5. Other than that, I'm in the fallout shelter. So I'm very grateful for that. But they were the first ones I tried, and then I just stuck with it, because once I got to know people, and I didn't want to go anywhere else because they were willing to take a chance on me. So I was more than happy to stick with them, because Joe, he gave me a promise, and that night out at SummerSlam, he was like, look, stick with us, we'll make sure you're a star, because we will trust you, as long as you trust us. Mm-hmm. And then I think, so that would have been August, and then on the 1st of October, I made my debut for Battle Club, which is Joe Kane's promotion. Fallout Shelter is a feeder for Battle Club. So I started with them about mid-August. I had a conversation that weekend, and then by the 1st of October, I was making my debut. So they put that trust in me. So I was more than happy to put the trust in them and stay with it. So that was in August. I'm still with them now. And I think, was it last month? I want to say last month, I got promoted to be a captain as well. So that was more trust they were putting in me. So it's the decision I made very early on is proven to come up successful every time.
So I do have a question that's kind of related to this through the old Instagram, but because I realize I kind of bloody read this thing without next to my face. I've got Colossal Mike Law. He asked, stylistically, throwing a big word for me, Mike, thank you very much. Stylistically, how's different wrestling in Scotland as opposed to the United States? So we'll go for the training wise. How different is it stylistically between the two?
So Mike Law is one of the coaches at the Fallout Shelter. He's one of the head coaches, and he's one of my favourites because we're both very much in a technical style. So I think the major difference for me so far between America and here, it's just because it's 1-to-1 when I'm here, it's or 2-to-1, and I normally get a training partner, and now obviously because there's no pandemic to keep us apart. Am I giving thumbs up? Keep my hands out of the way.
Didn't even notice that. So I don't know if that'll come up on the video. I kind of hope it does.
just seen it pop up there. I'm scratching my nose and I'm giving thumbs up. I think mainly in terms of training, because I do one-to-one here, it's very focused. Like, I always end up sweating buckets and like getting really blown up when I'm training here, because it's really focused on physicality, aggression, like just really full on for an hour and a half, but it's just me. Whereas when I'm training in America, there's a group and it's a team effort, and we all work together to put together spots, and we put together like drills. So you'll do your drill, you'll get blown up during your drill, but then you get to have a rest. So it lets you stay, I think it helps you stay focused for longer. Like here, sometimes like, oh, we'll do this chain of events, and like, because I'm so blown up, like by the end of a session, I'm just like, oh, Chris, what was I going to do again? And you just start improvising. Whereas, like, I think it's a good balance because it teaches me, like, as you're going, as you're getting blown up, as time's going on in a match, say you're 15 minutes deep, like, you're able to stay on your game. So I think both of them help in different ways. But technically, stylistically, I think it's now, initially I thought they were very different, but now I feel they're very similar because I'm more confident to kind of go, well, here's how, like, from the stuff that I watch, here's how I want to kind of portray this thing, and here's how I want to portray this thing. And both sets of coaches are very good at incorporating that into their drills. And, like, one of my favourites is just chaining, like, just go and chain. So, like, at the Fallout, like, sometimes on a Tuesday, it's we're big mixed sessions, so you'll maybe get 20 people in at once. So it'll be a case of, right, we'll split in half. Some people are staying here and doing bumps. The other half are going out on the crash pads with care, and you're going to chain on the crash pads. And we do the Chris Hero drill, where it's like, start chaining, and the minute you repeat something, you need to break off and start over. So, like, it makes you get really inventive. So, like, I like bringing the two kind of styles and flavors and kind of mixing them together and getting a nice hybrid style that I feel like I've got now, that's kind of birthed here, but, like, focused, like, in America.
I nurtured in America, kind of thing.
Yeah, so. Yeah.
Okay, so that all kind of makes sense to me anyway. Layman.
I do. I've got a really bad habit of talking, like, around the question, but then eventually landing on it, so there we go.
Absolutely fine. I don't know if you've noticed already, but in, like, the 45 minutes or so that we're talking, I start with a point and then go, oh no, I've got a question to ask at the end of this. I need to kind of get back into there so I can ask the question at the end. Yeah. It always just ends up with me revealing far too much about my life on a podcast. I think last recording I did, somehow, some way, I somehow called my mum fat. I don't know how I did it, but I ended up doing it. And it's for an episode that's not even out when this goes out. It's coming out, like, next week in this timeline of events. Mm. But yeah, I don't know how I've gotten this far with the podcast, because I do sometimes just open my mouth and let my belly rumble and just eventually get to a point.
We get there.
Exactly. So you mentioned your debut then. That's a nice wee segue to get there. We've got loads more questions, which we'll eventually get to. Against Anthony Gamble, I've got here.
Yep.
There's a name I recognise, though. You were accompanied by Masa Slamovic.
Yep.
Which I think AEW, I think she's popped up on AEW or Impact.
She's been on Dark, but she's now signed to Impact, and she's running a nice undefeated streak on Impact just now. So she's been good to watch.
So it's nice to have that kind of, you're working with someone that has like actual TV experience and all that kind of stuff, which is cool. I was checking out the rest of the show as well. You had Simon Gotch on there, of course, which by the sounds of it is definitely a wrestler right up your street if you like a technical style.
Yeah,
things. Wanna go? Yeah.
Simon Gotch. That was one of my first, like, real kind of, like, starstruck experiences in wrestling. Obviously, it was my first show, so I didn't have, like, much of a chance to get that. Otherwise, obviously, I had it with the guys at Girders because they were the first guys I watched. But, like, the first proper, like, TV guy that I got to meet in this kind of journey was Simon Gotch. And he'd done a seminar before the show. I learned so much from him. But I think he gave me some of the best non-advice I've ever received. Because obviously this was my first match, I was really nervous, and I just wanted people to like me, even though I was meant to be heel in the match. Because, like, I thought I knew what I was doing, but I wasn't confident in it. So I asked him, I was like, what's your biggest piece of advice you would give to someone starting out? Like, this is my debut tonight. What's your biggest piece of advice? And he goes, so do you know what you're doing? I was like, yeah. He was like, have you planned your match? And I was like, yep. He was like, right, are you comfortable with the person you're working with? Yeah. Are you confident in your own ability? Yeah. He was like, right, cool. Well, who am I to give you advice then? You know what you're doing, so you're just going to go and do it. And people will receive it well or they won't. But you're confident in what you're doing, so it doesn't matter. and everything will be in a learning experience. And I was like, that really did not help my nerves. But looking back, I'm like, that was some of the best non-advice I've been given, because as much as he meant it to be non-advice, it was really, really good advice. Because I've taken that forward now. I'm just like, right, I'm confident in what I'm doing. I'm confident with that I can work well with this person. And I'm confident we can put on a good show.
Like it was, yeah, a mental checklist every time. So if you sit down and go, right, I'm feeling nervous about this match. Have I done this? Have I got this? Am I feeling this? Can I do this? Cool, right. Yep. Everything's checked off. Next, let's go.
Kind of, yeah, 100%. And it keeps the nerves in check every time. But that first show was a great learning experience. The debut match itself was good. Like we had quite a while to kind of work on it and stuff. And Gamble, we worked together at the Fallout Shelter, and we're really good pals. So like it was really easy for us to just go in and kind of work together. I've worked him a couple of times since. He's really easy to work with. So that was nice for him to just be like, right, come on, we're gonna do this, we're gonna get you over. And that was basically the goal of the match. Having Masha there in my corner was great, because Masha, and in the other corner was Steve Pena, who are another two coaches. The four coaches we have at Fallout Shelter are Masha Slamovich, Steve Pena, Jorge Santi, and Colossal Mightlaw. And Law and Santi had matches later on, and then Masha and Pena were in our corners for that match, then had a match against each other later on the card. But it was great to have Masha in that corner. I think there's a picture on my Instagram where I'm sat up on the buckle and she's just kind of tapping me on the shoulder. And she was just like reaffirming. She was just like, you've got this. Like, you know what you're doing. You're going to kill it. Just stay calm. And I really needed that, because I was sitting there on that corner, like staring at Gamble coming out. My mind was going a million miles an hour. And she was just like, look, it's cool. It's fine. You know what you're doing. You just need to be confident in it. So it was good to have that reassurance of someone who I now really, really look up to. And it was great to have her in that corner, just giving those words of assurance. And during the match, being right down my neck, making sure I was like laying stuff in and making sure that it looked good. It was nice and aggressive. So that was a really good calming presence there. But that whole card, I just sat behind the curtain and just watched. Like, I didn't watch much of the show. I think I watched the main event and that was it. But I just sat behind the curtain and just watched everyone planning matches and going over stuff. And like the triple threat, Simon Gotch, Santana, who is another amazing individual. He's come by the Fallout Shelter many a time. He's amazing. And Mick Drake, who's the franchise champion at Battle Club, another amazing individual who's a fountain of wisdom. The three of them planning their triple threat, I was just mesmerized. They were just bang, 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 bang. They planned a 20-minute match in like 5 minutes. And I'm sitting here and I'm like, it took me like a week to plan our like 8-minute match. Dear God, how am I going to do this? But yeah, they just planned it. Bang, 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 bang. Went away. Come back about 10 minutes later and ran over it. Bang, 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 bang. And then I went up and I watched it and I was like, holy God, like that was like exactly what I just saw them, like Looney Tunes style, like zapping at each other. I just saw them play that out like perfectly in front of everyone. It was amazing to see.
It's one of those weird things. I've had a very limited experience watching wrestlers plan their matches. There was a time I saw Luke King Sharp planning a match with a couple of guys, and he was in the ring and he was doing the thing. He was showing like, if I do this, we can do that, and then we go into this bit, and I thought, oh, that's quite interesting. And then I watched the match that evening, and I saw the bit they were talking about, and then I saw it go wrong, and I would have been, other than Lou and the guys in the ring, I would have been the only person that knew that, oh, someone's forgotten something,
right?
But they still made it work to make it entertaining. But it was quite intriguing for me to see Lou's face kind of drop a little bit, going, fuck, we've missed a bit here. That's fine, we'll recover. Then they recovered and it was absolutely fine, and nobody would have noticed it unless they knew what the plan was. And it's very interesting to watch as an art form, and as someone who's watched it for 23 years at this point. You got to find it new, entertaining, and ways to enjoy it, even if it is watching it going, oh, see, they've done this and they've done that.
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
And then the next match will just be like a pure comedy, and I'm just laughing away, going, this is the best thing I've ever seen. So it's that's why wrestling's ace. It's just such a
amazing.
Weird thing. Right, so where we're on. So, first match then, Big Swole was the other name I caught on that show card as well.
Someone who has helped me a lot. She's incredible. I think, I've gotten a really good relationship with Swole since then. She was really good with me on that first day. Another real calming presence. And that was another one I was really kind of starstruck with. And since we've worked a lot of the same shows, and we've got a really good rapport now, where she's just happy to she'll tell me when I'm doing good, but she is also just as quick to go, hey, that was shit. And it's so worthwhile. All the coaches, everyone involved with what I'm doing, they're all very much cut from the same cloth. And I think that's why they all get on and they're all in the same circle. But they will tell you when something's good, but they are just as quick to tell you when it's awful. And it's so valuable to have people like that around you, especially in a business like this.
Absolutely. So unfortunately, because you're still quite new, you don't have a cage match profile just as yet. So I was piecing together bits and pieces, mainly just stalking through your Twitter, just to find out where we're at for what you were doing in the interim. So from that, I've got then in November, you had a pre-show match on We Are Wrestling. That ended up you being announced as being part of their roster from that match going forward. So you're wrestling at the Fallout Shelter, Battle Pro, all part of the same kind of thing. What was it like expanding a little bit into a different promotion, like We Are Wrestling?
So going from Battle Club and doing that in October, that was the first experience. And then going over, it was interesting because We Are Wrestling and Battle Club, they're like family. Everyone knows each other. Everyone's very close. And Mike Law, he was one of the agents on that show as well. So that week, because I was, so that would have been, I think that would have been December, just before I come back home for Christmas. Because that week I had spoken to Mike at training. I was like, look, I know it's late in the day, but I'm really looking to get more experience under my belt. I've got a taste for it now. I really want to get more experience. What are the chances of a pre-show match? He was like, right, no promises, just go. Have your gear. I was like, right, okay, cool. And we were in the car heading over there because it was in New Jersey. So it's in Ridgefield Park. It's like a 20-minute drive from Manhattan. It's not far at all. But we were in the car over there, and I got a phone call from Mike. He was like, yo, have you got your gear? And I was like, yep, it's in the boot. He was like, perfect. You've got 15. You've got a pre-show match. We'll speak to you when you get here. I was like, right, okay, cool. Get there, start getting ready, start planning my match and stuff. And the door to the office swings open. They're like, get out in here. I was like, oh no, what have I done? I thought I'd done something wrong. I was like, who have I pissed off? Whose hand didn't I shake? A million things going through my head. Like, right, cool. We need you to do us a favor. Your pre-show match is now a 5-minute match. I was like, oh. And they're like, but you're going up. Because later on in the card, one of our guys hasn't shown up. We need you to fill in. And the social media championship match against the Big Game Leroy. And I was like, awesome, cool. So this was my first double duty. I ended up on the pre-show against El Trabador, who was great fun to work with. And then later on in the show, I got called out and I had an Invictus social media championship match against Big Game Leroy, which was also a lot of fun. Leroy's character, he wrestles with a Nintendo Switch, so it's a lot of evasive style and just a lot of video game based stuff, so I was right on board with it, and it was a lot of fun working that match, and it was a good showcase for me, because it got me out of the little circle that I was in between Fallout and Battle Club. It's all family, everyone's supporting of each other. I was going into something else where it wasn't too far of a stretch, but it wasn't as such a controlled environment for me. So we went out there, and it turns out there was a lot of people that had been at the Battle Club show and had seen me before. So there was even though I was still heel, there was a lot of people. There was a lot of people cheering, and really, it was surprising because I remember coming back after the match and Leroy coming to me and was like, "Yo, I'm like a big baby face here. I'm not used to getting booed." He was like, "Yeah, it's because those people that are big Battle Club fans, you said Fallout, so they make the link instantly because they know, all right, these are the guys that are working from Fallout, so it's got to be one of these guys." So they get excited. They see me coming out. That's why they were getting on your back, because you were beating up a Fallout kid. Not necessarily you're beating up KJ Mack, but you're beating up a Fallout kid. So they got on your back a bit. So that was quite an interesting experience. And then I came home for Christmas almost immediately after that. I think that was on the Friday, and I came back here for Christmas on the Monday.
That's quite an amazing thing that if you didn't just take the initiative and go, can they do a pre-show match, none of that would have happened.
Yeah.
Because you wouldn't have been there. You wouldn't have had your gear. Or you probably would have been there, but I suppose you're a wrestler now, so you have you always have your gear.
I learned that's the number one rule.
Just keep your gear simple so it's nice and easy to pack.
Yeah.
And then from that, my research kind of has a big gap in between all of that to your first full show weekend just recently this month. Mm. You did WrestleLab Showabunga, which is an amazing title, and I saw the poster as well, and it was even better when I saw it, because you know it's a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, so what more could you want? And then Victory Pro Wrestling, and then you had your matches at Fallout as well. So was there I don't know if you ever had a point where you're like, I don't feel like I'm a wrestler quite yet, but when you have a full weekend of bookings, is that a moment where you go, yeah, I'm a wrestler now?
So I think the first moment of yes, I'm a wrestler now came a little while before that. So in April, we had a show on the 20th of April. It was 4:20 over there. So we had a show with Battle Club. It was my second time around with Battle Club. And we had an all-women's show called Women Crush Wednesday. It was the second time they put on this show. It was an amazing show. But we did another show. It was pre-show, but it was a second show on its own, and all the men's Battle Club titles got defended. So me and I'm in a tag team now called the Scott Aricans, my partner Dave Rivera, and our manager Jordy Effing Lee. She's great. So we have like our own little three-person group, all from the Fallout shelter. And on that show, I got to compete for the Battle Club tag titles in a four-way elimination match, which was great fun. So that was really cool, and I enjoyed that. And then that weekend, I worked for Pro Wrestling Magic in New Jersey again. And what had happened was, so this is bringing it back around to the question, the first time I felt like, I'm a wrestler now. Basically, on the Friday, I'm a Kilmarnock fan. So Kelly won the league on the Friday night. On the Saturday, I was working at Pro Wrestling Magic. So me being me, in my entrance, I wore a Kelly top to the ring. So Yokai, he, amazing as he is, takes the video of the entrance, posts it online. He's got a big social media following. It finds its way back to Kilmarnock and then back to New York, because on Sunday I went to see Biffy Clyro at Irving Plaza in New York, and at the end of the gig, someone in a Kilmarnock scarf and a Scottish accent approaches me at the end and was like, "You're that KJ guy, right?" And I was like, "I'm sorry, what?" And he was like, yeah, the guy that did the wrestling with the Kelly top. And I was like, yeah, how? And it was like, oh, I'm from Kelly, like it gets sent home and it's come back, it was in a group chat I'm in and stuff. And I was like, that is mental, and my brain just melted. So that was the first kind of point of, is this what wrestling is? Is this what wrestling's like? Like, once people start recognizing you, is that when you're really like a wrestler? So that was good fun. And then obviously I had my first full weekend. So yeah, I did Wrestlers Lab on the Friday. That was a late in the day thing. That was on the Monday. I got a message from Joakim. He was like, "I've got a going away present for you. Not only are you on Wrestlers Lab, not only are you facing one of your coaches, you're facing Steve for the 5 points championship, which is one of Battle Club's titles. And he was just like, look, I want you to go out there. I want you to hit each other. You owe each other money. And I want you to steal the show. And we ended up going out there and we had a great time. It's actually getting, I know it's not as big here, but IWTV is the indie wrestling kind of streaming service in America. So Showabunga is actually going live on that tomorrow. Tomorrow night, stroke Wednesday morning. So I'm going to get to watch that back for the first time. So I'm nervous to see how it was. It felt good and the crowd reacted well to it. And then on Saturday, I did a VPW. They were doing a it was a birthday party. This blew my mind. I didn't know that this was a thing. It was basically it was this kid's eighth birthday, and his parents had hired us to come in and put on a wrestling show in their back garden for his birthday party, and it was a lot of fun. I had no idea it was a thing. And then on Sunday, I got to work finally with the Fallout Shelter. We had Seek Shelter, which was the first ever Fallout Shelter student showcase. And it was great to see everyone that I'd been working with since August really get their opportunity to show what they can do, because there's only so many opportunities. And if you're just starting out, it's hard to get some. And hard to get someone to take a chance on you. I was lucky and got over there at the right time and got a chance taken on me. So it was great when we were able to do Seek Shelter that all these guys who have this potential and are really working hard to give them an opportunity to kind of showcase. So I got to work that day. I got to work with the Scott Ricans again against the Gimmick Busters, which was our two coaches, Santi and Law. Which was a lot of fun. It was an honour to be in there with them. But that first weekend, I was like, right, okay, cool. I'm doing this weekend, then I'm flying to another country to work in 2 weeks. Yeah, now I feel like a real wrestler.
You mentioned the birthday party things. It wasn't a thing when I was growing up, but there is some places around about here that do it now. I'm sure it'll be folk that you will come across during your visits here. Yeah. I think Kiger and Lucha DS, they had a wee birthday party thing, and there's companies up here. It's honestly, I don't think I can justify it as at my age, but my wife's we're having our first child at the end of August, and I'm like, come on, yes, once you're old enough to use understand it this, we are booking it. And I'll be the one that's like cheering along, and they'll just be like, this is happening.
What's going on? What's happening?
You're going to enjoy this. You have to. And then 10 years' time.
I'm going to take these headphones out and run out of battery.
All right.
Can you still hear me?
I can still hear you. Can you still hear me?
Yeah. I've still got you.
Awesome.
Sorry.
So that's fine. So I'll be after you go to this birthday party, give it 10 years. We're throwing you to training, so you better like wrestling. I've already planned this child's life out. It's not even here yet. Right. So that's kind of we're up to date with your career up until what's to come. So we'll go back onto the Instagram, and I'll just really only look at my phone to try and figure out what these questions say. There's loads of non-wrestling questions, so we'll run our way through those. You mentioned Biffy.
Yeah.
So that's probably a good place to start. We've got a question from the guys at Dudes at Ringside podcast. They've asked favorite music. So what's your genre?
Favorite music is probably I'm very emo. Like, I had an emo phase that has been never ending. We were actually discussing it at dinner today. Like, I'm very pop punk, late 90s, early 2000s. So all your kind of Green Day, My Chemical Romance, Fall Out Boy, Bullin' for Soup, all that kind of stuff. That's right up my street. That's my favorite kind of go-to. I listen to everything, but that's my go-to.
Right. Got a lot of quite New York ones. So favorite meal. That's from Yes Cosmic.
Love Cosmic. She's another Fallout Shelter. She's great. But favorite meal. Do you know? Whilst I was over there, I took a real liking to a chicken and lamb combo over rice. That was my go-to Monday night dinner. Go down to the deli and get chicken and lamb on rice.
Sounds ace. Right. We've got Bambino underscore KC. What's your favourite New York Bev?
Arizona. Specifically, okay. Watermelon, Arizona.
Ooh. Is this a kind of craft beer kind of thing?
It's kind of like it's like Oasis, basically. But it's like big cans, and you get bottles as well, and they're a dollar. You get like a big, like, 750 ml can of like basically Oasis, but it's like tastes better than Oasis. Watermelon specifically is my favorite.
Fair enough. Right, so I've already asked that. So that's wrestling one, so we'll get that near the end. Yes, Cosmic's also asked, boxers or briefs?
Briefs, especially since I've started wrestling. Definitely briefs.
Fair enough. Right, let's go. I can't even read that as a name. Joaquin Morales, possibly.
Joaquin Morales, owner of Battle Club in the Fallout Shelter.
I was 50-50 looking at that name going, is it Joaquin or yeah. Anyway.
It's why I always, my go-to is Joe. I call him Joe. I was like, I can't go wrong if I say Joe.
Joe has asked, favourite part of New York that isn't wrestling or acting related?
Oh, right. You've really thrown a curveball. I thought he was going to at least let me have the acting. Do you know what? I just recently discovered it. Barcade. It is a bar where it is just like, it's an 80s arcade and it's really cheap drink and all the games are a quarter. It is my new favourite place.
I like you're kind of sticking with the Scottish stereotype of it's cheap, I love it kind of thing.
It's great.
I'm noticing that, and honestly, I'd be the same if I was over there.
It's a dollar. New York, yeah, especially in a city like New York where everything is so expensive. If you find anything that you can do for under $5, it's my new favorite.
So I've got a bunch of wrestlers. I'll try and like do it so we'll go back into wrestling towards the end of these bits. Yes, Cosmic's also asked, countries that you want to visit?
I've always wanted to visit Japan. I want to go to Tokyo and do the Tokyo Dome and stuff like that. I know it's kind of wrestling related, but I would love to do Tokyo. I'm also a big theme park fan, so I want to do all the kind of Disney and Universal parks around the world. So that gives you like California. I've never been to this is a hint nudge nudge to everyone in America. I've never been to the west coast of America, so I'd love to be out there and do like Hollywood, Universal and Disney, and do Shanghai Disney and Hong Kong Universal and stuff like that. So like all those kind of places would definitely be my go-tos.
That's the dream for me. So the Orlando or at least the American Disney's, the French one's great. I love it.
But
if you're gonna go for it, please go big and just go for the Americas. Right, let's see. That's a wrestling one as well. There's a lot of wrestling questions, which is always nice. It's the least you'd hope for when we're doing a wrestling podcast.
On a wrestling podcast.
Yeah. So to kind of start going back into it, Pretty Heels XOXO has asked, who would be your dream wrestler to share a pizza with?
More of my favourites, Pretty Heels, are also amazing people. Favourite wrestler to share a pizza with? It's got to be Riddle, surely. Sharing a pizza with Riddle would be a fun time.
It would have to be pure post munchies, because I mean, I'm sure if you're paying the majority, you're wanting at least half of that bad boy. And if he's on the munchies mode, it's a bit of a fight to get there.
Yeah, a bit of a scrap.
Right, so Pretty Heels also asking, back into wrestling, what was your original gimmick when you first thought about wrestling?
First ever gimmick. This is the thing, and this is kind of the origin of KJ Mack, actually. KJ Mack has been my in-game avatar for like every game where you can create your own person. It was always KJ Mack, like FIFA, SmackDown versus Raw, The Sims. Like KJ Mack was always the person I made because I could never get the person to look exactly like me. So I hated calling them Kerr because it didn't look like me. So I was like, right, we'll give them like this fictional name. And KJ Mack is just a condensation of my name. Is that even a word? I don't know. It is now. So like my full name, I'm cool putting it out there. My full name's Kerr James McKinley. So when I wanted to condense it, it became KJ Mack. So the original gimmick was it was like the Highland King KJ Mack was the original, and we've not striven too far from it, but it was basically like how Finn Balor has the demon, mm-hmm. KJ Mack would have the Highland King. Like that was the original concept I had when I was like 19. And then as time went on, I was like, you know, wrestling gear is expensive. So I just started buying stuff from like my current in-ring gear. So an exclusive for you. I'm making gear just now. I'm getting gear made. JJ Creations are doing me some great gear that was designed by my good friend, Danny Nemesis. And he basically designed me. I'm a massive video game nerd. Kingdom Hearts is my favorite video game of all time. And my favorite character is Riku. So I'm getting some Riku-inspired gear made. But when I started, I was like, right, look, I don't know how serious I'm going to take this. I don't know how far it's going to go. So I'm going to buy stuff as cheap as I can and go from there. So basically, I bought my boots from Sports Direct. I got a pair of cargo pants from H&M. And then I bought like a 10 pack of like gray tank tops from like a dollar store in New York. And that has been my gear until this point. So like as it evolved, it was just like really aggressive. But the original concept was the Highland King KJ Mack.
They did have a follow-up. How different is the gimmick from your current one? Which you've just answered.
Yeah, really. it's not too far, because the current moniker is the King of Scots, KJ Mack. So it didn't drive too far away. But like, we'll say that the gimmicks aren't sisters, but they're cousins.
When it came to the King of Scots tagline, I don't know if you're aware, but Wolfgang used that for a good little bit. Was that something that you had to kind of ask for his blessing on, or was it a case of using this?
When he was used, so he did King of Scotland, and I thought it was very funny because it made me think of, I know most people have seen Braveheart, but I don't know how familiar of the actual film people are, but the scene where they first meet Stephen, who's the Irish guy, and he's just like, where are you from? And he's like, my island. And he was like, you mean Ireland? And they're like, no, my island. And I thought that was hilarious. I always found that scene brilliant, because it's like, yeah, to everyone else it's Ireland, but to him it's his. It belongs to him. So I was like, how funny would it be if I, like, because originally I was heel. Like, I'm face just about everywhere now, but initially I was heel. And I was like, how funny would it be if it was just, I'm not the King of Scotland, I'm the King of Scots. I can be the king of a select number of Scots without being the King of Scotland. So, like, I can be a king unto myself and no one else and still be the King of Scots. So that was kind of the idea I had initially. Just it was quite funny where like I can be a king of myself and like one other Scottish person, and I'm still technically the King of Scots, plural.
Okay, and also kind of it lends itself, if you do decide to go back to the heel side of things, you can have a wee little Scott cult, and then you could be the king of them, and you know, there's plenty. I like how you've operated on a technicality.
Yeah,
that's the sort of pettiness I love. They're going, no, I'm right. But
yeah,
I'm king of Scots,
plural. I never said I was the King of Scotland. I'm the King of Scots, plural. There is me and one other.
I've spelt it wrong. It's supposed to have two T's. I've got my mate Scott here, and I'm the king of him.
Yeah.
There's plenty of ways to go with it. That's ace. I like that. I really like that. Right, that's what we've got biggest influence that got you into wrestling. That's Abraham_CanPro.
Abraham Can, another one I want to put over. One of the best wrestling minds in the business right now. He's currently doing some amazing stuff with the Control Your Narrative guys. He is awesome. He's I was very close to calling him Battle Club. He's not Battle Club, he's Federated. And I'm sure we'll get into that at some point as well. But Abe's Federated, he's awesome. But biggest influence in terms of my own style in ring, probably Cesaro, BT Gunn are probably the big two. And then I laugh now because when I look back on my debut, I was really trying hard to be John Moxley. whereas now I've kind of spanned out and kind of found myself a bit more. But in that first match, I was like, yeah, I was just trying to be John Moxley. It failed miserably. I was nowhere near as cool as John Moxley, but he still kind of influences the style now. And then a lot of like World of Sport, like technical stuff, like all the Johnny Saint, Kid Dynamite stuff, where they're just tying each other in knots. Like that stuff, I love it.
And you talked about Federated. Conveniently enough, the last question I've got on this, well, second last I've got on this list is Elliot BMF316. Assume that's yes. One of the other coaches.
Yeah.
He's asked, ask him if he's as much a fan of Federated as his tag team partner, D.
So, Mr. Martinez, he runs what was, to my knowledge, he can correct me if I'm wrong, was a bit of its own kind of company. It's now spawned into a bit more of a faction that's trying to spread like weeds and take over the world. They've been day one Battle Club. They've been there from the very beginning. And they've got some scary dudes in there. But they've also got Abe, who just recently turned on the Fallout shelter to join Federated. And Mr. Martinez, Elliot himself, is trying to recruit some more Fallout students over to Federated. But I'm more than happy to be Battle Club's John Cena to Federated's Nexus. You won't find me defecting, but they do some great work. They've got champions in many different promotions, all very talented guys. Mr. Martinez has a very good eye for the business. He knows talent when he sees it. But as I said, I will call myself Battle Club's John Cena to Federated's Nexus.
Fine. So we have a couple of questions. Don't know if you've listened to any of our previous episodes of the show. We've had a couple of names that'll probably be a bit more familiar to you outside of. We've had Big Damo, we've had Joe Hendry and the like on the show. Somehow, don't know how, just luck. We asked two silly questions. First one being, what's your favourite dinosaur?
Favourite dinosaur is the made-up one in Jurassic World. I always forget its name.
Indominus Rex, is it?
That's the one. Indominus Rex. I thought that was a great invention.
It goes invisible and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah. I thought that was so cool. It won me over so quickly. They were like, it's not in the pen. And they're like, it's definitely in the pen. No, it's not in the pen. Oh no, it was just invisible the whole time.
I think that was possibly the point. I mean, I'm sure there's still entertaining films. I haven't seen any since.
Yeah.
As somehow a dinosaur connoisseur, I haven't seen any since Jurassic World, but I think that's possibly maybe when it jumped the shark a little bit.
Yeah. Do you know, I've always been a big Jurassic Park fan, but like real life dinosaurs, probably very basic, but I love a Stegosaurus.
Yeah, that's a nice classic one. Of course, it's such an open interpretation question. You can even use fictional ones, which is what you have done for the Indominus Rex. Who knows, actually? We don't know. They could have been real.
Maybe. Who knows?
Who knows? And the other question we ask everyone is, what would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
Damn, that's...
It's hard-hitting questions here.
I think it depends on the battlefield, in all honesty. I think if they're in a ring, I think the sheep annoy the cow to the point where it just submits. But if they're on, like, a hill, I think the cow, like, punts the sheep down the hill.
I love this question so much. It's a ridiculous question, and everyone always almost overthinks it. And it's a wonderful question to ask. And I can't believe it that I'm still asking it. That's a Luke King Sharp and Krieger specialty that's stuck for about 100 episodes now. Right. So let's get on to what's coming up then. So as of release of this podcast, tomorrow night you'll be making your homecoming, your return to Iron Girders, but this time to wrestle in the Iron Girders Gauntlet to determine the entrant to the final entrant for the IGWP championship tournament.
Yeah.
There's a lot of words there. Everyone knows. It's a mouthful. So you're in the ring with quite a few folk. I'm seeing some of the names that are getting announced for it. A lot of fresh faces. I've only maybe seen once or twice in other shows, other promotions. What's it like going back to Iron Girders this time as an actual wrestler at this occasion?
I'm really excited for it, in all honesty. When I started, I thought Girders was going to be my start. And then obviously life throws you a curveball, end up in America, and that happens. And I end up working over there. But coming back, I feel like I know some people, like me and Darryl, we've trained together. And I know some of the names that have been announced, but I feel like because it's for the wild card spot in the tournament, and I feel like I'm the wild card among the wild cards, where I don't think many people know what to expect from me, which is just the way I like it. Because then you can turn up and show what you can really do to a fresh audience. I'm calling this the KJ Mack homecoming tour because I want to put as many dates on the diary as I can. And hopefully that's the first one, and hopefully it continues on to many different. But I'm really excited because this is also going to be my first Rumble. So it'll be a fun experience to get in there and get a countdown and an entrance, get your Rumble moment. So I'm really excited. And it's also going to be the first time that a lot of my family and friends have been able to see me wrestle as well. So that's like really important to me more than anything else. Because it's been quite grounding, I suppose, where I've been away 4,000 miles away, and I'm just kind of sending stuff to people like, oh, look at this cool thing I'm doing. Like, and to them, it's nothing. Like, it's just, it's
context. Yeah.
Yeah. So it's really cool that a lot of the people who love and support me here are going to be able to see me do what I think I do best, and just really get behind me and kind of enjoy the occasion more than anything else.
Right, and there's a lot of people on that show already, so there's plenty, because the tournament begins on that night as well, so it's going to be a very interesting show. So for whoever's listening to this point, they haven't got a ticket yet, then probably best to get one. Not just for seeing the homecoming of KJ Mack, but got the likes of Kez Evans, Leighton Buzzard, I've got to remember the names that are on it. I think LJ Cleary, BT Guns, one of the matches. So
very excited for that.
There's a lot going on that show, and it's the beginning. It's always nice to come into a beginning of a company and seeing the first couple of matches, see how it grows from there as well. It's always good. So the other date you have is about the month after. It's in June.
Yes.
I've written down 26th of June. I'm hoping that's right. I've actually got Logan Storm asking a question about it. It's the last question I've got through the Instagram. I just asked, hopes on your Pro 2 debut. So we don't know what your match is at this point. We do.
We do know. We do know.
I should know because I got the exclusive jump on the announcements.
Exclusive, if you want to make that announcement live on air.
I'll find it. It is on the website. If anyone wants to go to swnscotland.com, they can do.
Live and pre-recorded on air.
panic. See, I was speaking to Daisy Jenkins of FPWA, and we were talking about, she's a big Harry Potter fan, and we were talking about where our houses are. I don't know if you've ever done the Pottermore.
I'm a massive Harry Potter geek. I am a Gryffindor with a Basset Hound Patronus. Love it.
She's a Gryffindor as well, which I found out. Well, I didn't find out, but it became very clear to me that I did it, and I'm a Hufflepuff. And when I go back and do my podcast and do like moments like this when I'm not prepared, and I should be, I was like, of course I'm a bloody Hufflepuff at this point.
My whole family are Hufflepuffs. Actually, I'm the only one that's Gryffindor.
I want to be a Gryffindor. I have a Gryffindor hoodie, but I am not. I am definitely Hufflepuff, which is, yeah, that's my life. Right, so yeah, you've got a Scottish Interpromotional Championship match. You're against Saqib Ali. So you're coming to Scotland for your homecoming. You're starting with a possible championship opportunity, and then in June you've got another championship opportunity. So this could be the title tour at this rate as well.
We were speaking about it, Joe and Yokai back at the Fallout were like, look, we're going to need to just start calling you a prize fighter at this point, because my main show debut for every company has been some form of title match. So obviously the Girders is an asterisk. It's a rumble for an opportunity to be in a tournament to get an opportunity at a title. We'll asterisk that one, but every other one's been a title match. My main, because my debut was on a pre-show, but my main show debut for Battle Club was for the tag titles. My debut for Wrestlers Lab was for the 5 points. And then obviously in Pro 2, it's for the Interpromotional Championship, which I'm really looking forward to. Because obviously, even though I'm a long ways away, I'm still watching ICW every week on the network on Peacock, because it is over there, and I've been keeping tabs on it. And Saqib's someone that I've really enjoyed watching, especially when he was doing the stuff with Darrow a few months back. I was really enjoying it. So he's someone that I'm really interested to work with. Someone who is on my hit list. I have a hit list on my phone that's got like 50 names on it. I think he's one of the first 10. So I'm really excited to work with him. But hopefully, fingers crossed, that we put on an absolute barn burner of a match in front of a very excitable crowd. And hopefully I get asked back again. That's all you can hope for, is that you're asked back again. Because it means that you've done a good job and that they trust you enough to do it again.
Are there any other companies that you're looking to maybe tick off while you're over here for the homecoming tour? I mean, I'm just getting my wee calendar up here to see what's on over the next over the next month or so, because that's what we do here at SWN. I've got all the info. So yeah, we've got things like Fair City, Clyde Valley Wrestling, Discovery, of course, W3L. There's so many companies about that have got shows on in the next couple of months. Is there plenty of maybe stuff you can't announce just yet, but is there plenty of nibbles
at the moment? So there's plenty of companies I would love to work with. I've tried hitting up certain places. Some places have heard back, some places I haven't, some places have got space, some people haven't, and I totally get it. It's like, the thing is for me, like, I understand I'm coming here as a total unknown commodity. Like, that's the thing. Like, no one knows who I am or what I can do. So I'm hoping with these first two, doing podcasts with people like yourself, I can hopefully get the word out and get a few more bookings on the calendar. I'm here until the 28th of August. So between now and then, I want to get a nice chunk of work to take back with me over to America. Because I go back at the end of August, and then that's me again until like next summer. So I'm desperate to get some work done. I'm desperate to start ticking some people off the hit list, because there's quite a few Scottish names on there. So I'd like to start ticking some of them off. I want to perform in Scotland. I want to perform in England and Wales and Ireland. There's some places down in England I would really love to get to. Of the ones that have started back up again, I really want to get back to UBW, the place where I did those first couple of sessions. I really want to get back there and be like, look, here's what I've become from what you guys saw in that church hall, those six training sessions in late 2019. Like, I want to go and show these people, like, look at how far I've come and look at what I can do. So if anyone is interested in getting in touch, please do. My DMs and my emails are always open, but yeah, there's a lot I'd like to do.
Right. That's just a good attitude and selling yourself. It's all good. We do. I mean, Pro 2 is one of probably the perfect places to get your name, because they have, they seem to kind of get a lot of people that have contacts to expand further. I mean, they've got Luke King Sharp on the show, and I don't care how many times I say this, but he's the guy with all the network links. He's got this lot. I don't know how he keeps all these contacts, but I've always said he's 5'4", but when he stands on his little black book, he's about 7 foot, because he knows everyone, it seems, that he's able to get hold of. And they've got quite a few promoters themselves through Pro 2. So if there was ever a place for you to kind of go, of course, I mean, Iron Girders, you got the best, some of the best wrestlers in the country there. So it's not a bad way to go either.
That was one thing for me, especially when I come back, and Logan will tell you, like, I've been pestering them for months. Like, I've been on them. I'm like, I'm available these days. Is there any chance I can get on? What about this date? What about this date? And then they announced the June show, and I was like, look, June, you've literally just announced it. Surely you can't have anyone on. Because I was desperate to work there, because they're Ayrshire based, and I've grew up and lived my life in Kilmarnock until this past August. And anyone that's bringing a good promotion and something good to Ayrshire, I always want to be a part of that. Especially, like, I live in Kilmarnock, so, like, anyone that's going to bring anything to Kilmarnock that's going to help the community, raise the profile of the community, especially if it's something I'm passionate about, like wrestling, like football, I'm always going to want to get involved. So as soon as I knew that Pro 2 were doing stuff in this area, doing their stuff in Irvine and Ambank, like, I really wanted to get involved. So I was really pestering them for months. And then eventually when the June show got announced, he was like, right, okay, cool, let's talk. And I was like, I was so happy when I confirmed that date in the diary, because any time that I can do something in Ayrshire, it means a lot to me.
Great. I came into this interview with pretty much very little information on you, little information, but I could tell from the last hour and whatever, how long we've been speaking for, that that I like the sound of your work ethic and your attitude, and it all sounds like you're just taking any opportunity you can get and making the most of it. Before we kind of wrap up, we do have a fantasy question at the end to round off the show. But as you're an actor, I'm going to ask a little bit about movies, and then we'll kind of wrap up, because you're not here for a long time, so be as well not take up all of your evening. So acting, of course, what's your favorite movies? I know that's a very loaded question, but throw a couple out there.
I have like two answers to this. My favorite genre of movie to watch is horror. Old school horror, new horror, bad horror, good horror. Like, I'm wearing like a Bride of Frankenstein shirt just now. Like, it's love horror. The Halloween Horror Nights at Universal is like my favorite time of year. But my favorite movies, favorite of all times, Back to the Future.
Nice.
It's just my number one. You cannot touch it. It is. It's always been one of my favorites, and especially now, because I grew up a theatre kid, they've now got the musical in London, and I need to get down there and see that over the summer at some point. But Back to the Future is definitely my number one. Like, series, like, I love Harry Potter, I love Star Wars, I love all superhero movies. Controversially, I prefer DC. I prefer DC. I prefer Batman to Marvel. I'm just a massive Batman fan. I love Batman's Rogues Gallery and stuff. So, and I'm a big Spider-Man fan as well. So I'm more Batman and Spider-Man than DC over Marvel kind of thing. Mm-hmm. But yeah, Back to the Future is definitely my number one.
Excellent choice. I can't argue with it, because they are just fantastic. I even love the third one, and that's the one, again, people go, that's the weakest one. I don't care. It's amazing. I've got a little, I don't know if you collect your pops, if you're in your collection.
Oh yeah, I've got a big stack of them over there. There's loads of them.
Usually it would be in my background here. I'd have a whole stack, so if people are watching past episodes, they would have seen them. But I've organized, and it took me a long time to convince my wife to hang that shield up. And as soon as I got the green light to do it, I was like, it's going up. It's going up there. But so. I do have, hang on. My little.
There we go. Beautiful. I think I've got a little dark brown over there, but I don't have the DeLorean. I actually, it was for Christmas, my parents actually got me a Playmobil DeLorean. And do you know the thing was, I was absolutely delighted with it. I say this all the time, I have the worst case of Peter Pan syndrome. Like, I'm a 10-year-old kid in an adult's body. Mm-hmm. So like anything like that, I'm always going to pop for it. So like when I opened that up and I had a Playmobil DeLorean that I could put together and sit in the corner of my room to display, I was so happy about it. But yeah, anything back to the future, I'm all over it.
I absolutely get that, because I mean, you can see the background also. I can never remember which way over my shoulder is. Also got a Mjolnir hammer as well, and that was like, that was like a present from my folks like 2 years ago, because every time they asked, oh, know what to get you, we've bought presents for years, and I was like, I really just want a Thor's hammer. I don't care at this point how old I am, I just want a Mjolnir, and it's a foam one, so it's nice and safe.
Just want cool stuff. I don't care who it's for.
Exactly. Like, I mean, I bought all the belts myself. These are all my own purchases. Buy me cool stuff that I don't need grown-up things. I've got plenty of grown-up clothes and stuff, and just get me cool things that I can hang up instead. Right, so let's get the fancy question in, and we can wrap up our evening. Vince McMahon phones you, or insert your favorite promotions head. Vince McMahon's the easiest one for me to remember. He's phoned you up and he's went, right, we've got a space in the main event of WrestleMania. I want you in that match, but you get to pick your opponent or opponents, the stipulation. You get to pick everything. What is it? Mm. Oh, they have to be alive. I keep forgetting. They have to be alive.
Right. Now, the fantasy element of the big name and stuff, I would love like a false count anywhere, a last man standing against Edge, specifically for the big gold, like the World Heavyweight Championship, specifically for that. But I do love a like, bringing your friends with you kind of thing. So I would love the Scotticans to win the tag titles against the New Day. I think that'd be a lot of fun.
Going Edge and Christian as a third. There you go.
There you go. Triple TLC. Fatal four way. Throw the Hardys in there as well.
Oh, nice. Easy. That's it. That's can't go any higher than that. Perfect. Well, thank you very much for speaking to me. Before we go, though, how can people find out more about KJ Mack?
So, easiest way is through my social medias. On Instagram, I'm KJ Mack Wrestling, and on Twitter, I'm KJ Mack Wrestler. Because very annoyingly, on the vice versa, someone had the other one already. I think that because they're all getting bought by each other now, it's actually just recognized it's me. It's me that's got username, but it's just not letting me have it. It's strange. But Instagram, KJ Mack Wrestling, Twitter, KJ Mack Wrestler. Follow any of the Battle Club and Fallout Shelter social medias. They are also on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook. Follow all the Iron Girders stuff, because they'll be around there for a while. And if you want to see more independent wrestling, especially, obviously it's more America, but IWTV and Title Match Network. They both stream indie wrestling events every week, and there's a massive, massive library. All of Battle Club stuff, all of We Are is on Title Match Network, and Wrestlers Lab is on IWTV. So I'll quickly plug that actually again. Tomorrow, it will be around 1 a.m. UK time, but it's 8 p.m. Eastern time in America. Wrestlers Lab Showabunga goes live. It was an amazing show. And I got to fight one of my coaches for his 5 points championship, and it is most certainly my best match to date. So if you want to see what I'm all about, you want to see my style, get yourself an IWTV subscription. It's not that expensive, and go watch that match when it releases tomorrow night / Wednesday morning. and also get your tickets to Iron Girders and get your tickets to Pro 2, and you'll get to see me live and in person.
That's fine. I was about to do the wrap up myself, mentioning Iron Girders, but you've done it for me. Excellent. But no, thanks very much for good luck for tomorrow. It's weird when we're recording it earlier in the week, but good luck for tomorrow, and hopefully we'll see you on a couple more promotions before you jet back in August. But no, thank you very much.
Thank you very much for having me.